Oh, yeah, right.
Have you seen Earl's new movie?
The one about,
doesn't use the Atari.
Right, the one about the paint of the photographer.
Yeah.
I have seen it. Yeah, I give him big points for completely departing from his style and doing something different.
When to some degree, you've done, and now we're talking, but you've kind of done that too, even though...
Well, I've done that more than him, for sure. My, Earl Morris film up until this one, you watch 2 minutes of it, it's like, oh, it's an Earl Morris film.
Yeah.
I don't think that's true of my work at all. I mean, there are things, are we rolling?
Yeah.
Okay. There are things that, there are things about my work that, some of my work that I think if people who have seen my work associate with the kind of films I make, you know, whether it's Hoop Dreams or The Interrupters or films like those where, you know, it's cinema verite, it tends to be gritty, you know, in the moment kind of stuff. And I love that kind of filmmaking, but that's, you know, if you look at my body of work, I've made lots of different kinds of films. And, you know, Abacus certainly is an example of one that deviates from that template.
And you're present in the other film. I mean, I guess the films you're most famous for, you are in.
Well, Hoop Dreams, I narrate it.
Yeah.
But it's very functional, and most people, frankly, don't even remember, if they haven't seen it recently, they don't even remember that there is any narration, which is perfectly fine. A film like Stevie, yes, I'm very much in. I did a film for ESPN on Allen Iverson, a 30 for 30, that I'm in because I went back to my hometown to try to understand. So yes, I'm in some of the films. Life itself, I narrated and I appear briefly because, you know, Roger told me to shoot myself in the mirror. So I did, because I did whatever he said. So, but yeah, I mean, again, I've done enough films now. There's most of the work I've done, I'm not in at all.
Well, was that a change for you when it first happened?
The first time I was in it?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, because I never anticipated or imagined that I would be a filmmaker that put himself at all in any of his films because, you know, I did not see myself as that kind of filmmaker. I certainly didn't see myself as a, you know, Michael Moore type filmmaker, nor did I see myself as a kind of confessional, you know, first person kind of filmmaker. But when I went to make Stevie, it seemed like the right thing to do given where that story went because, you know, it ended up being a story about a kid, a former kid that I had been a big brother to and, you know, came back as a young adult and he was charged with this very serious crime, a sex offense. And, you know, I found myself sort of falling back into trying to be a big brother to him in the way I had been when he was really young and I had actually been a big brother to him. And so I felt like if I was gonna make that film and follow this very difficult time in his life about what's gonna happen to him and I was actually trying to play that role, then I should be candid about it and make that part of the film because otherwise it wouldn't feel like a very honest film. So, you know, I'm very much a part of Stevie in a way that I haven't been in any other film I've done.
It's just funny because you're so not Michael.
No.
I mean, not that there's anything wrong with being Michael, but it's like, yeah, it's not your shtick.
No.
And yet when Stevie happened and when your voiceover in Hoop Dreams happened, which was really the thing that kind of broke you out in terms of the public consciousness, it was only then that Michael was, you know, that whole first person documentary was beginning to happen. It was all very mazily before that. And God forbid anybody should know you were ever there.
Yeah.
You know? So.
Yeah, no, I am not Michael Moore, and I'm sure he would be the first to agree with that.
Much taller.
I'm much taller. Some people say I'm funny. You know, I've now hosted the Cinema Eye Awards twice now. Maybe you've missed my comic stylings.
Unfortunately, I have.
At the Cinema Eye, that's because you're in L.A., so you probably never get to that. But no.
I get invited. I vote.
Yeah, you're good. Good.
Yeah.
But I've not really been funny in any of my films. You know, maybe that's to come. I look at every film I do in a kind of very sort of practical and creative way. And maybe people might think of those as sort of paradoxical in some ways, but I look at them as how best do I see, and it's just my view of how to do this? How best to try and tell this particular story? And to what degree can it be, in my view, more honest and insightful? So for a film like Stevie, that felt like the most honest thing to do. For a film like No Crossover, The Trial of Allen Iverson that I did for ESPN, me going back to my hometown and trying to understand race and this tremendous, you know, fissure that opened up over Allen Iverson being arrested as a teenager in a racial bowling alley brawl was my attempt to try to understand something about my hometown. And so it has a level of candor and honesty in even me revealing some of my own, you know, shortcomings, if you will, about race growing up. So it's as well honest in that way. Mm. A film like Life Itself, you hear me narrate it in very minimally, but you hear some of my interactions with Roger, because the fact that he died 4 months into our filming, it became clear to me that for me to try to fully tell of what I captured with him, I needed to feature email correspondences, not just in-person filming, because he was only there for 4 months. Mm-hmm. So it just became a kind of aesthetic choice that I felt took me closer to showing all of who he was, right? So those are the kind of things that enter into a decision about what I do and don't do, you know. And you may look at these films and go, I think you made the wrong choice. You have a right to say that. But that's what governed the choices that I was trying to make.
Well, I guess it was just more, when I saw Abacus back in Toronto.
Yes.
It's like, oh, it's like, you know, a different...
This is a very different...
A different Steve James movie.
Yeah, and I would say that of all the sort of films that might be more departures, if you will, like Life Itself, a biography about a famous person, I've never done that before, really, you know. Mm-hmm. Yet it had verite storytelling in it, because I was filming Roger during what turned out to be the last 4 months of his life. This film also has that aspect. We mm-hmm. follow the Sung family as they navigate this trial and the stress. And as is true for a lot of the films that I have done over the years, I enjoy following people at pivotal moments in their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, Roger, it didn't start out to be that way, but it ended up being, in fact, an incredibly pivotal moment, because he was wrestling with cancer that ended his life. In this film, it was like, yes, okay, we're going to be there with this family for this time of this trial and sort of see how they deal with it and how they come out the other end, not knowing how this trial, of course, was going to turn out. But it's not just that kind of verite film, clearly. Mm-hmm. If I had gotten access to the prosecution, if I'd gotten access to the defense team during the trial, as well as the family, which we did have access to, I probably would have made a very different film than the film we made. And if I'd been able to be in the courtroom. But none of those things happened. So for me, a lot of... I over the years, I've come to believe that, you know, documentary filmmaking is as much about dealing with what you can't do as much as what you can do. And how do you solve that problem? And so for me, this film was a real sort of challenge in that way. It's sort of like, okay, we've got access to the Sung family, thank God. I mean, there's no film without that. Yeah. But how are we going to bring to life the trial itself that they were spending most of their day in, that we couldn't see? How do we bring that to life?
So you weren't even in the courtroom without a camera?
No, we weren't allowed to have a camera in the courtroom.
But were you yourself able to go in the courtroom?
We visited a little bit, but it was frustrating to be there. And you know, and I had to also pick and choose the time I was in New York to do this film, because we did it on a budget. You know, we did it really on a budget. And it wasn't, you know, if this trial had been in Chicago, it would have been different. It wasn't. It was in New York, and I'm in Chicago. So we had to kind of be really strategic about when we went in, and then when we were there, we tried to use our time during the day when they were in court to get other things that we needed. You know, you try to be purposeful. So there are a lot of things about this that, you know, one could look as at as obstacles. But I'm not sitting here trying to make excuses, because I'm really proud of the film we made. And to me, I feel like we found ways to solve those restrictions in a way that, you know, I think allowed us to try and tell the story of a trial that's a paper trial, as people often derisively refer to a fraud case. Oh, it's mm-hmm. a paper trial, you know, meaning there's no murderer, there's no weapons, there's no sexy, you know, storylines. Mm-hmm. We had to try to tell that story, bring it to life, while tracking this experience for the Sungs, and that's the film we made.
So how did you get involved in the first place?
I got involved because Mark Mitten, one of the producers who worked with me on Life Itself, and I go back about 10 years with Mark, he first hired me to do something for him for an Olympic organizing effort in mm-hmm. Chicago. He was friends with the Sungs. He had met Vera 10, 12 years ago and become friends with her socially, and then kind of got to know her family as a result of that. And she was telling him about this like crazy trial they were going through, about to start and go through this ordeal. And it was all allegedly connected to the 2008 mortgage crisis, which they were bewildered by, and bewildered by the fact that they were even going on trial to begin with. And so Mark told me about it, and I was like, I don't know anything about this. And he was like, no one knows anything about it unless you read the Chinese American press in mm-hmm. New York City, because it wasn't being reported on. And the only thing out there of substance at that time when the trial began was Matt Taibbi in his book, The Divide. Mm-hmm. The introduction to that book is about the indictment of Abacus, because the book came out before the trial. Mm-hmm. He wrote as an introduction to his book, The Divide, which is about the unequal application of justice in America, he told the story of the indictment of Abacus. And it's a great, great chapter and a great mm-hmm. introduction to this story. And so Mark said, read that and tell me what you think. And I read it and I said, okay, well, let's go to New York for a few days and start filming and see if we feel like there's a film to be done.
So how important was context to you? I mean, obviously the story became about the, you know, small enough to jail.
Yeah.
Was that context critical from the beginning to make you interested? Or
I think so, because I think if it had just been a fraud case in New York City of a Chinese American bank that had no connection to the 2008 crisis, I don't know if that would have been sufficient enough for me to think, well, that's a story that needs to be told by mm-hmm. someone like me, you know what I mean? Coming mm-hmm. from Chicago, who knows nothing about you know, it's like, I might have said, you know, it's a good story, but that's probably, you should talk to a New York-based filmmaker mm-hmm. and see if you can interest them in it. It'll be a lot easier for you. And, you know, but the fact that, you know, when you look at the perp walk, mm-hmm. you know, when you look at these mostly former employees being paraded down the hallway in chains, who were low-level loan officers, not hardened criminals nor dangerous, you know, alleged criminals. Mm-hmm. You look at that, and then you look at his press conference, Cyrus Vance Jr., the DA of New York, and the way in which he was so explicit about connecting what went on at Abacus with 2008 and this notion that, you know, what they were doing relates directly to 2008 and was part of the problem of, you know, the whole spectacle of it all and the grandstanding that went on in that. Mm. I mean, that you look at that and you go, okay, well, what's really going on here? Mm. And when you find out that the bank discovered the fraud themselves, reported the fraud, initiated their own internal investigation, which they weren't required to do, which resulted in relieving at least two other employees of their jobs, and then cooperated with the DA's office up to the point where they realized that they were the focus now of the investigation, instead of the DA's office was going to help them root out any fraud that might still be going on. Mm. When you look at that, you go, this, and they're the 2,651st largest bank in the United States. You look at it and you go, this is the mirror opposite of the big banks. That's what this is. And in every way you look at it. And so to me, that's like, well, that's an incredible story. But when I went to New York, given the lack of access, mm-hmm. had I not been totally sort of taken with this family, I don't know if I would have thought, well, you know, I can do this story because of the limited access. But when I met the family, I was just like, they're incredible.
Why didn't you have access to their defense?
They were nervous, you know, I believe me.
The family or the lawyers?
No, the family was okay with it, but we had to deal directly with the defense lawyers. They were nervous about having us be around because they, even though I pointed to many examples of films where the filmmakers have access to the defense, they were worried that it might in some way impede what they were doing or that it would, that it could come back to bite them somehow legally, you know, subpoena. And, you know, I tried to assure them of all that. And, you know, the truth is that a lot of films that are done where you get access to prosecution or defense, the filmmakers are able to sort of play on the kind of egos that are quite usually substantial on the part of lawyers. They want to be a kind of, they want their due and they want to be at the center of it all, right? And filmmakers love that, of course, because then they say yes. These defense lawyers, they were very significant lawyers and highly regarded lawyers. I mean, the Sungs didn't just hire anybody to defend them, but they were remarkably free of that kind of like desire to be front and center. You know, they didn't interest them. That was frustrating, honestly. I was like, come on, you've got to let us into that, you know. We tried with the prosecution, we tried to get Vance repeatedly, and it wasn't until after the verdict that we were able to finally get the prosecution side into the case.
So why do you think they decided after they lost to
I think it was two things. I think it was one, they still felt, and you see this in the film, they still felt very, very strongly that they were right and that this was the wrong decision. And it comes through in everything they say. You know, there's not an ounce of, well, maybe after all, we had it wrong, or maybe we should have thought this through differently. No, they felt like they had right on their side. I think the other reason was we had a, there's probably three reasons, really. We had a co-producer who came to us once Frontline became involved, which was after the trial. And Nick Verbitsky did a terrific job of hunting down every juror and approaching them, because we knew, given the way the verdict and the long deliberation, that we wanted to have jurors represented. Polly Greenberg, who had been head of economic crimes in the DA's office, had left the office, and that gave us hope because she was out from under the thumb of it. And so she was able to make the decision solely for herself. And she still felt very strongly that they were on the side of right. And we were like, great, we want that view in the film. So we got her first. Then we got the juror, the one who was a holdout. And then we got Vance. And I think that Nick was able to finally convince Vance's office that we were serious about getting their viewpoint in. And then the third reason, and this is not third as in the least of the reasons, but the third reason is that once we became a Frontline documentary, that brought with it a kind of credibility for them. And I think it also brought a bit of a hammer, because I think that they calculated that Frontline's integrity as a news magazine counts for something, and it's also like, do they want? I can't know what was in his heart, but I imagine he probably said, "I don't know if I want to be. I refuse to cooperate. I refuse to cooperate. I refuse to cooperate, despite repeated attempts." You know.
Well, they knew it would be on Channel 13 eventually. Huh?
Yes.
The hometown powerhouse.
And Frontline has a substantial audience, and its audience, they have a very influential audience. I mean, a lot of people who are movers and shakers, they watch that show.
So do you have some sort of understanding as to why they think they were right after all the evidence was that they weren't?
I think they felt like that there was too much fraud going on for the bank to not have either orchestrated or endorsed it or, you know, encouraged it in some way. But here's the thing. There was a fair amount of fraud going on, but you can't look at all the charges and say, oh, wow, my God, because it is a, you know, when you're a prosecutor and you're bringing charges, right, you bring as many, you throw as many charges as you can possibly drum up, because as you find out towards the end of the film, if you succeed in one of them, out of all of them, you've won, essentially. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not like a football game or a basketball game where if the Sungs are found innocent of 80 charges and guilty of one, they've won. No, yeah. they've committed a felony and they've been convicted. That's all that counts.
It's like a soccer game.
Yeah. So
they kick the ball 80 times and only gets in once. You only expect it to get in once.
Right. So it's right. It's not about shots on goal. It's how many land. Right. Yeah. So it's like they threw a lot of charges, and you know, we didn't have time in the film to dissect all of these at all. You know, but. Mm-hmm. You know, if you look at a lot of these charges, a lot of them are very petty. And a lot of the kinds of charges they are the kinds of charges that are, you know, people inflated or underreported their income. Well, newsflash, people have been doing that for mortgages in everywhere in America for many, many years. I'm here to confess that I inflated my income when we went to get a mortgage for the first house we bought. I wasn't making a whole lot of money, and I inflated the income, and I knew that they weren't going to look at my tax returns, so I could do that. And you know what? I'm also guilty of having received a gift from my parents to help with the down payment that I didn't tell the mortgage company came from my parents. Mm-hmm. These are the kind of things that go on everywhere, and they especially go on in an immigrant community that's based in cash. And especially in the Chinese community, where these kind of gifts are part and parcel of a culture, that's what they do. And all of this is explained in the film. Yeah. And so there was a real disconnect, I think, between the DA's office, and a willing disconnect between the DA's office and the realities of the way loans are made in the immigrant community, which is not to excuse the kind of fraud that did go on that was criminal, like Ken Yu.
Getting tips.
Absolutely. That's and the Sungs would be the first to tell you that was wrong, and that's why they fired him.
Yeah.
And that's why they tried to root out anything like that and get rid of people who were doing anything like that. So I think the DA's office, and this is a long rambling answer, I hope you're a good editor, but it's like, I think the DA's office just sort of willfully blinded themselves to the realities of the mortgage process, loan process in an immigrant community like the Chinese community, because it served their interest to throw a lot of charges at them with the hopes that some would stick and they would get that conviction. Because I think it's clear that Vance cared more about a conviction of a bank that he could connect to the 2008 crisis than anything. Because even when it came down to offering them a deal, the big banks were offered deals where they could pay fines and not plead guilty to anything. That's what they wanted.
Right.
Abacus wasn't even offered that. They were offered a deal to pay a fine and plead to a felony.
Yes.
And that's because, and so what that tells you is, yeah, the DA's office just doesn't want to have to go to the trouble and the expense of a trial, but they still want to get what they want to get, which is they want that felony. And of course the bank wasn't going to agree to that.
Well, the thing is that, I mean, during that period of time, the 2008 crisis, a lot of it was, you know, mortgage brokers who were inflating numbers and consciously inflating numbers and beyond what I'm sure you did with your house way back when.
That, oh yeah,
you know, like in crazy things.
Yeah, and right, and taking people they knew. Yeah. See, here's the thing, and this is the difference between Abacus, one of the fundamental differences between Abacus and the big banks. In the big bank situation, among many really crazy credit default swaps and these insurance scams and, I mean, all this stuff, it's like they were also, like, inviting people in who they knew could in no way qualify for this loan or pay off this loan, and they didn't care because all they wanted to do was get the loan and then sell it.
Right.
And once they sold it, didn't matter what happened to it. Abacus didn't do that. Even the loan officers who were engaged in funny stuff with the books were giving loans to people they knew were good for the loans, which is why Abacus has one of the lowest default rates of any bank in the country, 1/20th of the national average. And because
were the 9 in 3,000
nine loans in the 3,000 during the indictment period failed. And that's because whatever the fraud that was going on, much of which was extremely petty, they were good loans because Abacus knew their customers. And they were selling these loans to the alleged victim in this case, which is Fannie Mae. And this alleged victim, we should all be so victimized, they made hundreds of millions of dollars off of these loans, and they were an extremely reluctant victim in this case. And in fact, as soon as the case ended, they got back in business with Abacus because they loved doing business with them. And they recognized the unique nature of working in their community, that, you know, it's in the film that, you know, that they understood the ways in which Abacus had to work within that community to create loans for people so that they could climb up the ladder of the American dream.
Which is what they were supposed to be doing.
Which is what they're supposed to
do. And they actually did it, even with all this going on.
They did it.
The rate, the ratio has got to be, I mean, the 9 out of 3,000 has got to be as good a rate outside of that period of time. You know, like when it's the craziness is not going on, I'm sure you have 9 out of 3,000 tomorrow.
No.
You know,
Every bank in America would love to have anything close to that.
Yeah.
Which is why, I mean, this moment's in the trial when the defense lawyer asked the representative from Fannie Mae, you know, would you call the default rate of Abacus low? She said, yes, extremely low, yes. Would you call it microscopically low? And of course, the prosecutor, you know, objection, Your Honor, didn't want, of course, you would have said yes.
So how, the culture is a big part of this movie. How was that for you? You're not Asian, obviously.
No.
That I know of. And you're from Chicago and not from New York and not from that scene. And Chicago's Chinatown is nothing like New York's Chinatown, from what I can tell.
Right.
So was that, was it culturally difficult for you as a filmmaker, or do you just adapt to whatever you're...
Well, yeah, I mean, I think the thing that, and it's always true in every film I've ever done that takes me into communities that are not my own, which is virtually every film I've done, the key to that is you have to have the trust and the passport that comes with that trust of the people you're following. And if they are meaningful in that community, and in this case, Mr. Sung is a pillar in that community, then that makes it possible for us to go into that community with him or with Don Lee, the community activist that's featured in the film, who is a big supporter of Abacus. Don Lee, you walk around the streets with Don Lee and you know, he knows a million people and they know him because they know how hard he has worked on behalf of their community. So if we're with Don Lee, we're okay. And so that makes a big, that, you know, that makes a big difference. And that's always the key. I mean, in every film I've done, you have to have that in order to penetrate a community in a way that they will accept you in and open up to you.
But is there any difference for you when they're speaking Chinese or they're...
Well, that makes it harder. Yeah. Yes, that makes it harder. And I've, you know, I've done a number of films where people are speaking languages that I don't understand. And in those situations, you just have to, you have to kind of, and your camera person, in this case, Tom Bergman, who did a terrific job, you have to have good instincts about reading kind of like the temper of what's going on. You may not fully understand it. And you look for opportunities, like with a Don Lee, to say what's going on here, and he will give you a clue, and that helps. But you have to kind of read the situation, and you know, there's a way in which documentary filmmakers read a situation. They realize, okay, this person is upset. Something's going on here. I need to make sure I get that. And you kind of find a way to document it, even though you can't follow necessarily the conversation. And if you, you know, if you've been doing this for a while, and Tom's one of these people that's been doing it for a while, you kind of have a sense of how to do that in a way that we can then get the full-on translation and cut it into a scene that works.
Do you get surprised sometimes when you get the translation?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Well, and usually it's pleasantly surprised. I mean, you get a sense that, okay, I know, like, for instance, you know, this person is really upset about a ticket they've gotten, from the city, you don't know all the particulars until Don kind of tells us, and he tells us in English in the film too. But the nuance and the degree to which, like, the kind of outrageousness of that ticket, where a city cop basically in a unmarked car has parked, you know, illegally, causing them to have to move, you know, it's. So some of that you don't quite get until,
right,
you know, you get the translation, or you don't get the kind of emotional quality. You know, that's in the case of the scenes in this movie around that, it's the emotional tenor of how strongly that person feels. You see it on their face, but when you hear them express it, then that's a whole other dimension.
So how are you feeling about all this stuff? This movie is, for everybody who's seen it, has been a happy, kind of amazing experience. But you know, the question of how many people see the movies and
right,
where they get distribution and how much distribution,
right,
you know, is how much does that affect your life at this point? Or are you just kind of, have you become inured to not being able to control it and just kind of floating through?
Well, you know, when it comes to theatrical release, it's hard to know anymore. Well, it's hard. It was hard to know at any time. I mean, you know, without question, you know, the most successful theatrical film I've done was the first one, Hoop Dreams. Mm-hmm. And it's been all downhill ever since. But I've had films that, you know, that were successful theatrically within the realms of what documentary are these days. Mm-hmm. You know, the Ebert film did almost $1 million at the box office, which these days, that's pretty good, you know. It's not as good as any of us hoped. You know, we thought Roger Ebert. But, you know, I try not to get too caught up in that, because, first of all, I feel like, and a film like this especially, it's true, if you can have a vigorous festival life, that is very meaningful. It's very meaningful for the subjects of your film. It's very meaningful for the filmmakers. And it's a really great way to sort of gauge how audiences are, you know, affected by the films you do. And that's very meaningful. When it comes to then the theatrical, I kind of tend to look at the theatrical like that's as much about raising awareness for the film as it is putting butts in seats. And you know, if you can get both, fantastic. But it's still true that the theatrical release, it's a changing landscape. You know that better than I probably, but it's like, it's still true that a theatrical release does help drive press and internet, attention to a film in a way that a festival, except a Sundance or, you know, a top tier festival, doesn't.
Yeah.
And so that's still important, even if the film doesn't get to every market you'd love to get it in, or it doesn't. You know, it's not a huge success, but hey, as we sit here today, we're going to be 3 weeks in New York for a film that's not had hardly any ad support. You know, I'll take that.
And the choice to go with Frontline at the point at which you were, I guess, in production, is that always a good idea? I mean, I don't know what happened. It was true with Interrupters also, I guess.
For Interrupters, it was great, and actually, Frontline was in earlier on Interrupters, and they were a key part of the funding while we were making the film. For, you know, and they were great partners. And on this one, they didn't get in until post, well, not post, but after the trial. We were still filming interviews and stuff, but you know, knowing we had their support meant something financially to the film, and then and knowing that we had their imprimatur, obviously, as I mentioned earlier, was very helpful, and knowing that this will eventually be on Frontline is great for a film like this, just like it was for the Interrupters. You know, I feel like you kind of get your cake and eat it too in that way. It's hard when you have U.S. broadcast rights sold. It makes it hard for theatrical distribution these days. It didn't used to be so hard. It's gotten harder. That's one of the downsides. But I think you have to kind of weigh what your options are there.
Right.
And funding is a big one. And also thinking, well, you know, once we go through the festival and theatrical life of this film, hopefully, we want it to have a big impact when it gets to television. And so having that down the road for a film like this is great. You know, when Interrupters aired on Frontline, it was a 2-hour Frontline special about urban violence in Chicago. It was not exactly subject matter that the typical Frontline audience gravitates to. And they told us that this, you know, they were a little worried about it. It actually did quite well. And the thing that shocked them was is that the people who came to it online and downloaded the movie to watch, it was the highest at that time. This is back in 2012. It was the highest.
This is years ago.
Yeah, ages ago. But it was up until that time, it was the most downloaded Frontline film yet, with the exception of when they did on
when Harry Met Sally,
when the Afghan, you know, the murder of Bin Laden.
Bin Laden, okay.
When Bin Laden,
killed Bin Laden or whatever.
Well, yeah, it's like the story of how that happened.
Right.
That was outside of that, which is a pretty big newsy story.
Yeah.
The Interrupters was the top downloaded film on Frontline, and they were amazed at that and thrilled at that. So. You know, I take all of that into account, and it's like, I feel like you have to these days because you want people to see the work, ultimately.
Yeah.
And I feel like, you know, I feel like I've been fortunate to kind of get the best of both.
Because the parade of all the new, Life Itself was on CNN.
Yeah.
Ultimately. Having all these companies out there now that are competing, are you feeling that, or is it just kind of a few more companies and a few more doors to close?
No, I think it's great. I mean, I think, you know, we're living in a time where there are more places to go to show documentaries. I mean, people are, and a lot of networks have gotten into documentaries that you didn't, 5 years ago, you would have been, oh, really? They're into it? You know, like long form documentary. And that's great. I think, you know, I hope that's not something that is a bubble that bursts at some point and they move away from it. I hope not. But I think it's great that there are a lot of places to look and go for your films. And with Netflix, obviously, and Amazon getting into it, I mean, you know, this is huge for a documentary. Now, there are way more documentary filmmakers out there competing for those support, you know, for those networks and for support for the
films. Than
there
were 10 years ago?
Yeah, without question. You know, so, you know, when young filmmakers or, you know, ask me, like, is this a great time to get into documentary? I say, it is a great time in the sense that it's never been, there's never been so many documentaries being made. It's never been so easy from a tech point of view, an equipment point of view, for you to make a film. And there's more funding than ever and more places to show your film than ever. You also need to understand there are way more of you trying to do that than ever. So there is a kind of leveling process that goes on in that regard.
So you were grandfathered in, kind of.
I'm lucky. No, I'm lucky. I truly am lucky that I got, you know, my big breakthrough film, obviously, was Hoop Dreams. And that opened up a kind of possibility for me as a doc filmmaker that I'm still, you know, I mean, I think if I'd made a series of bad films, I wouldn't be in this position, but it starting with Hoop Dreams, it's been possible for me, for the most part, to make the films I want to make, find a way to make the films I want to make. I've been able to, you know, in documentary. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when you think about that, that's very fortunate, you know. I mean, there I don't know that there are a lot of us that have been able to do that.
You haven't gone to Celebrities or Cooking yet, really, so.
I haven't done reality TV yet. And I've had offers to get into reality TV, but I have not
done
it yet.
No urge for that? No urge to?
No, I don't. I mean, I guess if the right thing came along and I thought it had real merit as a documentary, then I might be tempted. But I've been able to stay busy doing the things I want to do. So the idea of going and doing a reality TV show that someone pitches to me has not yet appealed enough for me to want to do that.
Hoop Dreams is still the longest? other films?
Well, longest standalone film. You know, we did a series at Cartemquin that was my brainchild back in 2000, came out in 2004, called The New Americans. Mm. If you haven't seen it, I can send you links for it. It's a 7-hour miniseries where we followed a team of filmmakers. We followed immigrants coming to America over the course of 3 to 4 years. Five different stories of immigrants coming from different places in the world, starting in their home country or a refugee camp and coming to America. I'm very proud of that series. I mean, it was a collaborative effort with a number of really talented filmmakers. And it's a 7-hour miniseries. I am in the middle of doing another miniseries now that's going to be even longer. So I do longer work.
So where does the one that's done live?
The New Americans?
Yeah.
It was done for PBS, ultimately. Uh-huh. You can get it from Cartemquin's website. Mm. You can buy it.
Somebody over there?
I could send you links as a...
I would love to see
as
that.
As a courtesy. I think you'd really like it. I mean, it's a really ambitious... I mean, we followed some really amazing stories, at least two of which could have been standalone documentaries in their own right, if we'd had the time to actually pursue that as a adjunct to the series, but we didn't.
So as we get to the end of our time, I've asked the immortal question, what's with you and the Academy? does it bother you anymore? I mean, it must bother you somewhat. It must be like a surprise every other time, or...
Well, I mean, you know, I'm not that. I mean, I don't really lose much sleep over it, honestly. I mean, I feel like, you know, when The Interrupters didn't get shortlisted, and the day before the shortlist came out, there were two articles, one in Hollywood Reporter and one in Variety, because they both actually interviewed me. Sort of handicapping the shortlist. And in both articles, they said, this was the one for sure film that was going to get shortlisted and likely nominated. Both articles made that claim. And then it didn't get shortlisted. I have to say, of all the times, I've been on the shortlist a lot. That one I wasn't, but I've been on the shortlist a lot and never been nominated. But of all the times, of all the films in terms of that, the whole thing, that's probably the one time I was angry about it, because I just thought, come on. I mean, I'm not saying it should win. Not on the short list. I was upset at that. I got over it pretty quick. And part of the reason I got over it, and this has been true for Life Itself and other times, part of the reason I got over it is because I got a lot of love for that film, for The Interrupters, and I got a lot of love for Life Itself. And I had a lot of people upset on my behalf for both those films. Mm-hmm. And in fact, The Interrupters, along with Senna and maybe another film, became one of the reasons Michael Moore went about changing the rules again. Mm-hmm. The last major time they had been changed was when Hoop Dreams got snubbed. And so I also felt like I had, in a weird sort of way, played a role, you know, in the Academy through being snubbed.
Are you a member?
I am a member.
You are a member.
And I'm even on the advisory committee this year. I was voted on the executive advisory committee, so I am serving the Academy. So, so what has been true over the years is that I feel like I have, if people are getting upset that a film of mine is not either shortlisted or nominated, that tells me that I've been successful in ways that actually, honestly, are more meaningful. I think if I was a filmmaker who'd made a film that I thought was really deserving, and there are a lot of them out there, and no one batted an eye when you didn't get shortlisted, or, you know, no one cared enough to even say, that wasn't right, then I think it would be more depressing. Mm. But I'm one of the lucky filmmakers who has gotten a lot of love despite all that and a lot of support, and I'm able to make the films I want to make, whether that ever happens or not. And so I get it when a filmmaker comes along who has a film that's a breakthrough film for them, and for them to get shortlisted and nominated, and my God, if they actually won, it could make a huge difference in their career. Mm. And I'm lucky enough to not have to be in that position. So I also am lucky enough to care less about it.
Yeah. No, I gave the Interrupters the Oscar at Sundance, I think. I was sure it was going to, I mean, people said I cursed it or something. But no, I saw it that night, there was a longer version of it.
Yeah,
but it was still, I think, one of the most important films of the last, 5 years or whatever it's been.
Well, thank you.
It's an extraordinary piece of film. I mean, it's an extraordinary story. It's a beautiful piece of filmmaking, and it is such an important piece of film that people need to see.
Yeah, and today, with what's going on in Chicago, it's still,
more than ever,
it's still intensely relevant. Yeah. But thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Ah, poor The Interrupters. Yeah, it's just, it's shocking every time, because it's like, it's so, you are held in such high esteem by so many people, and yet at the same time, it's like, okay, even life itself, I mean, it had a kind of built-in sheen to it that,
right,
I think may have turned some documentarians off on some level, but at the same time, it was like, the fact that it didn't get into the five was shocking for people.
Yeah, I mean, the handicappers and all that said it was a shoe-in or whatever. But it's like, you know what? That film got reviewed by more reviewers by a long shot than any film I've ever done. Mm. And it was, I got a lot of love for it. And we won plenty of awards.
We still do.
Yeah, I mean, plenty of awards and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. I mean, it did just fine. And I was sitting in L.A. with my wife, because they wanted to make sure I was in, the distributor wanted to make sure, Magnolia, that I was in L.A. when the announcement came out,
right,
so that I was positioned to do press, right?
Right.
And of course, so out here, the announcement's really early in the morning. So we were in my hotel room, our hotel room. I had the laptop open, and it was like, and because I've been through this before, mm-hmm, being on the short list, tuning in or going online and finding out, but this time it was being streamed, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're streaming and they make the announcement, and I know it's announced alphabetically.
Right.
So as soon as we got past L, I turned to my wife and I said, we're not nominated. She goes, oh, there's still some more. I go, no, we're not nominated. Sure enough, we weren't. And then, mm-hmm, honest to God, Dave, I just went, boom. Well, okay, whatever.
It's a nice hotel room.
And then we went down to breakfast. And then I got calls like, oh, do you want to talk about not being nominated? And I was like, no, I don't want to talk
the
about not being
calls.
Nominated. But you know what? I got some really terrific emails from some filmmakers, including two, Laura Poitras and Roy Kennedy, who were nominated. I got immediately responses from them, mm-hmm, expressing, their unhappiness with that, which was such a classy thing for them to do at a time when they were, to being thrilled about their own good fortune. And so it was, I felt more bad for Chaz, honestly, because she was out there in LA too.
Yeah.
And we went to breakfast eventually together, and she was a good sport about it, but I could tell it was hard because, for her, it wasn't about her personally. It was about Roger.
Yeah.
And she felt like, Roger deserved it and the film,
Did you see the Ruben Ostlander tape when he reacted to not getting nominated?
This is the
Finnish guy.
The force majeure.
Yes, force majeure.
Yes, I thought that was hilarious.
That's a classic.
That was hilarious. I watched that. Yeah.
Very funny, sweet guy, but the free guy.
Mine would have been the interesting anecdote. It would have been like you'd have been seeing me go. We're not going to be nominated. No. Boom. It would have been like the exact opposite.
That's right. Two sides of the coin.
Yeah.
It's perfect. See, his gets a lot more attention though.
Yes.
You got to know how to get attention, Steve. This is your thing.
I know. I get plenty of attention.
You're not the king of self-promoters, I would say.
No.
But you work hard. You work out. You go places to promote your movies.
No, I take it very seriously.
You're in a bunch of different countries.
I want people. I'm not one of these like, no, I'm not going to do interviews and all that. I want what's best for the film, and I want the film to do well and people to hear about it and go see it. And of course, it's flattering when people want to talk to you about your film. I mean, I'd much rather a lot of people want to talk to you about your film and write about it or shoot videos or record radio, whatever, than not at all. That's why, I mean, I think the thing I try to look at this is, I really, you know, and I know it sounds Pollyanna, but I really do feel like I am one of the luckiest people in this business. So how can I get that upset about an Oscar?
When you get to do what you want to do for year after year and
people
and get love
encourage
for
it. You know, they're like, yeah, keep doing it. You know, they're not saying, okay, enough.
You know, you should slow down.
You've had a good run. I think it's time to, you know, just take it easy.
Well, you know, you have until your 90s at least till
you know, Wiseman's still going strong.
And Wiseman is still going. He can't be stopped.
And the Maisels, you know, and you know, I mean, you know, I mean, he went. Yeah. It seems like he, you know, I've always said that I want to drop dead, like my face fall face first into the Avid just as I'm finishing the fine cut or something.
It's over. Maybe put a pillow there for you and
some boom.
Won't hurt too much.
Yeah.
I'd like to see that movie. Actually, Errol would do that movie. That would be Errol's.
Yeah.
If Errol did you, that would be.
Yeah, he'll never do me.
I actually thought about Errol. I watched Errol's newest movie and I thought about him passing at some point. I mean, not like it's going to happen next week, but it really made me sad to think of Errol not being around.
Yeah,
it's
well,
like such a strong
voice. It has an elegiac kind of tone to it, that film. And, and it's a kind of, you know, that's one of the things that's very beautiful about it. And so I can see where I didn't do that, but I could see where that would kind of conjure up sort of ruminating on his own.
Well, it's kind of a love letter
legacy
to himself.
And right.
You know, she is so much like him in a certain way.
Yes.
And the precision of the work, you know, and the specificity is so, you know, they're similar.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting. I'm enjoying it. It's a good year for documentary.
Yeah.
I think I saw a film that actually was almost, I keep on now comparing it to The Interrupters, called The Work.
The Work?
Which is, it's about a group encounter session that happens at Folsom Prison.
Oh, wow.
With like two dozen inmates who are, you know, all lifers.
Yeah.
And they bring two dozen guys from out of the prison who were kind of like volunteers. I don't know why. They do this twice a year for 4 days. And they do this very intensive workshop.
Yeah, yeah.
Where they're like, you know, there are no prison guards in the room. It's all cleared out because they want to be able to bring down their facades.
Yes.
In the process. And all the guys who shot it had to go through the process. And
yeah, that's great.
It took them like 9 years to make it. And,
Wow.
Till they finally could get it made. You know, it was like they couldn't get
clearance.
Is it the
same guys coming back every year?
Well, there's some guys who, like in the prison side, the guys from out of the prison are new guys always. And then the guys from inside the prison, there's some who've done it two or three times.
That's great.
They kind of facilitate. They're actual facilitators also.
Oh, that sounds great.
But
it's
so intimate and so much about the pain.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing about The Interrupters still that stays with me is the simple humanity of it and the simple urge to, you know, care for other people and to stop people from doing these things to one another. And this movie has a similar feel to it.
Oh, yeah. So. I really look forward to seeing it.
You're still a big Doc fan?
Yeah, I just I feel like I don't see enough of the other work people are making because I'm so busy.
Yeah.
I get
the giant box, right?
I get the giant box, but you know, I don't get very deep into it. I tend to see more stuff when I'm on the festival circuit with one of my own films because I do make a point when I'm on the festival circuit to see as many films as I can. I don't like just going to the festival and, you know, socializing. I mean, I like socializing, but I really like to see stuff. And a lot of times my wife is going with me and she's you know, she's going to everything. And so I try to do that as well. So, you know, I don't do badly, but there's a lot of great films I have not
seen. It's kind of impossible now to keep up.
It is impossible.
Like you were saying before, just anything that stands out is helpful because breaking through the clutter is brutal these days.
Is hard, yeah.
Yeah. The good stuff and the bad stuff.
Yeah.
You don't really know until you're watching it.
No, I mean, you know, when I was a kid or you were a kid, you know, it's like, first of all, documentaries didn't really exist in that way. But even in narrative film, right, it never seemed like there was just this overwhelming number of films or records, mm-hmm. you know, music or books that were coming out. There were a lot, but it never seemed overwhelming. And there was a lot less than now.
Yeah.
And so...
Well, they went away back then also.
They went away, right, right. There was no way for them to live on, but there was also a lot less. And I think that, you know, so it may be true that the same number of books, CD music, and films break through as ever. It's more like, you know, we're all crabs in the barrel.
The name of your next movie. I like it.
Crabs in the Barrel. Trying to claw our way out of the barrel. Over top of each other.
Easier if you're not in Baltimore.
That's right.
Then you're getting eaten
exactly.
too. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate
sure.
it. As ever.
It was really enjoyable.
Thank you.